Ten Commandments of Jesus Christ. This morning we'll meditate part 5, Ten Commandments of Jesus Christ. If you love me, John 14:15, keep my commandments. 14:21, he that hath my commandments and keepeth them, keepeth my commandments, he it is that loveth me. He that has my commandments and he that keeps my commandments, he it is that loveth me. John 15:10, if you keep my commandments, you shall abide in my love. If you love me, keep my commandments. If you keep my commandments, you shall abide in me. Jesus' commandments. In the Old Testament, the commandments of God, they are generally, the Bible scholars say, 613 commandments. And that was in a concise way said, 10 commandments. Again, the 10 commandments were made to two. Love God, love others. Now in the New Testament, especially in the Gospels, we see some of the commandments of Jesus Christ. What Jesus commanded his disciples, what Jesus commanded the people, which are even applicable today, are the general commandment Jesus gave to the church. So out of all those commandments, we are meditating on 10 commandments. In those 10 commandments, we'll be meditating many other allied commandments. We have seen already 4 commandments. Number 1, we studied, receive the Holy Ghost. The Christian life starts with that. The church started with that. The life of Paul started with that. The life of Cornelius started with that. Receive ye the Holy Ghost. So to receive the Holy Ghost, we meditate 3 more commandments. Repent, believe, and be baptized. What does it mean, repent? Forsake the ways of sinners, ungodly. Forsake the evil mindset of the ungodly. Turn to the Word of God. Turn to the Word of God. That's repentance. And believe. What does it mean, believe? Believe that Jesus is God who came in the flesh. Jesus, God manifest in flesh. Believe that he is as he was. He is the Yahweh God. He is unchanging. Believe he is the rewarder of them who seek him diligently, whosoever it may be. He rewards them. He answers their prayer. He rewards them when they seek him diligently. He is respecter of no persons. So repent, believe, and receive, and be baptized. And be baptized, and receive the Holy Ghost. When you receive the Holy Ghost, number 2, you shall start following Jesus. Jesus said, follow me. Follow me means imitate me. What Jesus would do in a particular situation, in that situation, act like Jesus, that is following Jesus. When they are saying, Hail Jesus, Hosanna, 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 how would Jesus react to those Hosannas? Follow Jesus. When they say, Crucify Him, Crucify Him, Crucify Him, how would Jesus react to that? Follow Him. Whether it is Hail Jesus or Crucify Jesus, imitate Jesus. The Christians are called to imitate Jesus. And number three, Christianity is a kingdom life. He is the King of Kings. He has got His own kingdom. That kingdom has got its own constitution, rules and regulations. So it's a key gospel of kingdom. It's a kingdom of heaven, kingdom of God. It's a kingdom of God. So seek those kingdom principles. Be familiar with the rules and regulations of that kingdom. Abide by the rules and regulations of that kingdom. That kingdom is not based on eating and drinking. It's not based on some festivals. Christianity is not based on some festivals. Christianity is more a lifestyle. So what do you mean by seek ye the kingdom of God and its righteousness? It is peace. Seek peace. It is righteousness. Equity. What is right with God is right with me. Seek righteousness. And the joy of the Holy Ghost. Seek the joy of the Holy Ghost. That is the kingdom of God. Peace, righteousness, and joy of the Holy Ghost. That's the kingdom of God. So, Jesus' commandment, number one, repent, believe, be baptized, and receive the Holy Spirit. Jesus' commandment number two, when you receive the Holy Spirit, follow me, imitate me. And number three, seek, endeavor to attain. Familiarize with yourself. The kingdom of God. What's God's kingdom? What are the principles of God's kingdom? What's the right to live in God's kingdom? So come into the experience of God's kingdom. And number four, what we meditated last week, be perfect. Be perfect. So Jesus said, be perfect. It's not possible. In other words, you are saying, Jesus told us to do something which is not possible. You believe that Jesus told you to do something which is not possible. That's absolutely nonsense. Jesus cannot tell us to do something which is not possible. When Jesus said, be perfect, we can be perfect. We can be perfect. Be complete in Him. Be a finished product in Him. So we saw a few things. What is it actually meant by be perfect? What is it actually meant by be perfect? Be perfect is not the end. In that level, you are perfect. It's not, you haven't become complete. The story never ended. There's a big difference between the end and perfection. Perfection suggests there's still more. He that is holy, let him be holy still. See, there's an artist. He wants to paint a beautiful picture. So he draws the outline and all perfectly, to the measurement. A checkered paper for all the squares. When you see, you can see only lines, but very proportionately, perfectly, he has put all the lines. The picture has not yet come, but the setting he has done perfectly all right. He has not completed. He is still working on me. He has not completed. But the first step, he has perfectly done it. Then he has drawn the picture with the eyes, hair, nose. He has drawn it. And that work, he has perfectly done it. He paints it. Exact shades. Perfectly he has painted it. The work is not complete. He puts a beautiful frame to it. Perfectly fitting frame. The color of the frame matching to the picture. A perfect work. It's perfect. The outline perfect, the drawing perfect, painting perfect, then putting the frame perfect. So perfection is not completion. He wants to give that as a gift. He has not completed, now he has to do the packing. He takes every care very meticulously, choosing a color that could match the mood of that function, that celebration, bringing out the mood of the celebration, the packing paper perfectly matching the mood of the function. He packs it. Perfectly, with that ribbon, with a small flower, with an inscription. So perfection in every part, perfection is very, very essential. You can have completion even without perfection. Just to draw a few lines, not very perfect. Painting not very perfect. Framework is not very perfect. Some paper, some gift wrapper you got and you packed it. The packing is not perfection, but you completed the work. You completed the work. So here it says, not complete, perfect it. Perfect it. My dear brother, my dear sister. So, be ye perfect. Perfect in the will of God. Perfect in understanding. Perfect in love. In other words, be a perfect man. Be a perfect man. What is expected of a man? Perfection is, in that level, there is nothing more wanting. There is nothing more wanting. See, the Lord is speaking to you about baptism. You have taken baptism, you are perfect. The Lord is talking to you about receiving the Holy Spirit. You are not to receive the Holy Spirit. You are not taking care, you are not taking pains to receive the Holy Spirit. You are not perfect. So you receive the Holy Spirit. You have become perfect. The Lord is speaking to you about total holiness. Holiness in the spirit, holiness in the soul, holiness in the body. But you have got to struggle to be holy in the body. You have got your own arguments. You are not totally yielding to the arguments of the Word of God. So you couldn't become perfect. You know what the Lord says, but you are unable to obey. Different pressures, different situations. So you can't become perfect. So perfection is a process. So let us thus minded. Let us thus minded. Glory be to the Lord's holy name. Today I'm going to take the fifth one, a very, very important one. Every commandment is important. This commandment is very important. Jesus said, this do in remembrance of me. We are starting the fifth one today. This do in remembrance of me. If you love me, you'll keep my commandments. If you keep my commandments, you'll abide in me. So keep Jesus' commandment. Jesus said, this do in remembrance of me. What is that this? What is that this? That's called the Lord's Supper, the Lost Supper, the Holy Communion, Eucharist, etc., etc. We use the word the Lord's Supper. The Lord's Supper. Kartharudaiya Pandhi. In some place they say Holy Supper. Tirupandhi. They use the word Holy Communion. They use the word Eucharist. And I understood this was originally called Christmas. Christ Mass, Mass for Christ. In Tamil, some churches they call this Tirupali Mass, Tirupali. Later in this service, there's no joy. So they started calling Christmas as the birth of Christ. There's nothing to do with the birth of Christ. Christ Mass, Mass for Christ. My dear brother, my dear sister, the Lost Supper or the Lord's Supper, the Lost Supper or the Lord's Supper or the Holy Communion, how Jesus constituted that, or how Jesus originated that institution of the Lost Supper, the Lord's Supper. We read that in Matthew chapter 26, from verse 20 to 30, and Mark chapter 14, verses 18 to 26, Luke chapter 22, verses 14 to 20, and John, nearly five chapters, 13, 14, 15, 16, and 17. And also we read in 1 Corinthians chapter 10 and 11. So in all these six places, we read about the Lost Supper Jesus had on the earth. That was the Lost Supper Jesus had on the earth. So we know that historical background. It was the day that Jesus was to be betrayed. So if I put the sequences, they all came to the upper room. They are sitting for the supper. So while they were sitting for the supper, Jesus went about, washed his disciples' feet. It's the time that Jesus tells them that he will be betrayed. He'll be betrayed. They are the bread and wine, and the significance he explains. And Jesus says to Peter, Peter, you will deny me. And Jesus instructs his disciples what they should do. And then they sang a hymn and they went to Garden of Gethsemane. So they came to the upper room. They are sitting for the supper. Jesus washes their feet. And Jesus tells them that he would be betrayed. There's a course of conversation. Jesus says, what is the real leadership? What is the significance of the leadership and all? Then as a second part, Jesus institutes a significant one, a New Testament. He ends the Old Testament, begins the New Testament. He constitutes the New Testament. And he said, do this in remembrance of me. And there was the lecture about how to have peace in the Lord, etc., etc. When that was over, we read in the Gospel of John, chapter 15, 16, his exhortation to the believers to strengthen them. And chapter 17, we read about Jesus' long prayer in that upper room. Jesus' long prayer in that upper room. Then they all sang a hallel, a hymn. And they went to Garden of Gethsemane. They went to Garden of Gethsemane. We know the background very well. Jesus said, do this in remembrance of me. Do this in remembrance of me. How to do that? In the remembrance of Jesus Christ. Many a time, this Holy Communion or the Lord's Supper is equated with Passover. It happened on the day of the Passover, but there's a major difference between a Passover meal, what is otherwise called in Hebrew, Seder, the Passover meal, and this Holy Communion or the constitution of the Lord's Supper Eucharist. Doing this in remembrance, it's not Passover. Passover, Jesus died as a Passover lamb for our sin. But the constitution of the Lord's Supper is much different from just a Passover meal. So the things that you should follow for a Passover meal is much different from what you should do for this meal. For this table, Lord's table. So please listen carefully, then only you'll understand. I remember, if my memory is right, sometime back, I have brought out this difference to you in a different message. Anyhow, repeating that is not wrong, because many times we have got a wrong idea that the Lord's Supper is also a Passover meal. So the Passover meal is over. Now we read Luke chapter 22. That is very clear. Luke chapter 22. And when the hour was come, that's the time for them to have their Passover meal. When the hour was come, he sat down. Sat down for the Passover meal. And the 12 apostles with him. So the 12 apostles were with him. It was in their upper room where they prepared for this supper. So we read in the book of John, this is the time that he got up, washed their feet and all, and he told them that one who wants to be the master must be a slave. He told them that the Son of God has come not to be served but to serve others, etc., etc. And when he was talking to them, verse 15, and he said unto them, with desire I have desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. When already he started telling them about his crucifixion, his end, etc., etc. Now he was very specific. He said, this is the last supper. And I desire to participate in this Passover. John has recorded at least 3 Passovers Jesus participated. This is the last Passover Jesus participated. So Jesus says, I desire to sit with you for this dinner. Because this is my last supper will be with you. So he was just disclosing that. Verse 16, for I say unto you, I will not anymore eat thereof. This is the last one. Anymore, no more. I am going to eat. Until it be fulfilled in the kingdom of God. So he was talking to them about the kingdom of God. In the kingdom of Israel, their deliverance is with the slaughter of a Passover lamb, with the killing, sacrificial killing of a Passover lamb. The slaves came into a kingdom. They had their deliverance. They came out of Egypt. They crossed the Red Sea, went through the wilderness. They crossed River Jordan. Jericho fell down. They had victory over Ai, and they were able to kill or destroy 31 kings and 7 races. Their kingdom was established. The kingdom was established with the beginning of the Passover lamb. So tomorrow, according to Jews, on that day, this is happening in the evening. For us, it's the next morning. For them, it is the same day. When Jesus will be crucified, the kingdom of God comes. The people of God will have their deliverance from sin, as the people of the Israelites had deliverance from Egypt. Now, we became a kingdom people. When Jesus, the Lamb of the world, the Lamb that takes away the sin of the world, dies on the cross, he is our Passover. He is our Passover. So tomorrow he is going to be slaughtered. Our Father is on the same day, evening and morning one day. It is on the 14th of Nisan. He is going to be sacrificed. So in between he's not going to eat anything, and also he's not going to have earthly meal anymore. So he was moving towards the kingdom of God to be established. The establishment of the kingdom of God starts with Jesus, our Passover, being sacrificed for us. So he says in verse 16, for I say unto you, I will not anymore eat thereof, until it be fulfilled in the kingdom of God. And he took the cup and gave thanks, said, take this and divide it among yourselves. And again he said, he reiterated, for I say unto you, I will not drink of the fruit of the wine until the kingdom of God shall come. So beginning of the coming of the kingdom of God, beginning of the coming of the kingdom of God is with his death on the cross. Till that time I will not drink. It doesn't mean that he'll drink afterwards. With that his earthly drinks is over. My dear brother, my dear sister, now listen carefully, this is very, very important. Verse 19. And he took bread and gave thanks and broke it. Verse 15. And he said unto them, with desire I have desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. Just said eat. And he blessed the cup and gave them. Now probably, this is the time Jesus said, one of you is going to betray me, etc., etc. And he gave a piece to everybody, and Judas took a piece and went away. Almost the supper is over. The supper ended. In Matthew, we understand the supper part ended. But it's all going as one chain. So with reference to context, we have to understand. In Luke, it's more clear. So again in verse 19, he took bread and gave thanks and broke it and gave unto them, saying, this is my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. This do in remembrance of me. In the Passover meal, they were eating bread, but they are not eating bread in the remembrance of the lamb that was slain. In the Passover meal, they drink grape juice, but not in remembrance of the blood of the lamb that was shed. They eat bitter herbs, etc., as a token of the bitter experience they had in Egypt. So every year they have to do that in remembrance of that. But now he is giving a New Testament. It is not remembering the Passover. That's for our deliverance. Then what that Jesus says, do this in remembrance of me. Then again for the second time, likewise, as he took the bread, he gave thanks, broke the bread. It was something like our chapati or our bread that what we have at the Lord's Supper. He broke the bread, gave one to Simon, gave one to John, one small piece, eat this. They finished supper. Eat this, eat this. You are doing it in remembrance of me. You have to do it in remembrance of me. Do this. They didn't understand what is the new thing he is doing. Again, likewise also, the cup after supper, the cup saying, this cup is a new testament in my blood which is shed for you. This is the New Testament coming in. Earlier he blessed the cup, gave them. That's the Old Testament. There was a Jewish festival Passover. We are not celebrating Jewish festival Passover. Now it's the New Testament. In a very separate way he blesses the bread. He blesses the cup and he tells them, now you do this not remembering the Passover lamb. You do this in remembrance of me. In 1 Corinthians chapter 11, even when he blesses the cup and he gives the cup to the people, there also he said, do this in remembrance of me. Paul records that. Do this in remembrance of me. So I want to bring to your attention the spiritual significance behind it. That you read very clearly in Jeremiah, in the book of Jeremiah, in chapter, I think it was 16:7. It is something like our memorial service, doing something in remembrance. What does it mean by doing something in remembrance? A father or a mother or a grandfather, some person died in a family. So one of the head relatives, say mother died, the father. A father died, uncle, periyappa. After all the ceremonies are over, generally it would take 40 days. He would gather all the members of the family. He would gather all the members of the family. So the mother, the father has died. That man's wife will be there. Sons and daughters will be there. Son-in-law, daughter-in-law will be there. The grandchildren will be there. Now the periyappa will have that bread. Their father lost a few days, 30 days. They are not eating properly. They are not taking this grape juice. Some bland food. They are very sad. They had this tukka kanji, vyahula kanji, something like porridge. They are not taking any solid food. So as we have that dukkha nivirti kutam, visesham, karya. So they would gather all the people, break the bread. It is to break their dukkam. And as he was distributing the bread, that periyappa will say, remember your appa, remember your daddy, remember what all he has spoken, remember what he told you when he was alive. You should be goody-goody people. See, brothers, anandami, you should not fight. You know what your father has said to the wife? Don't worry, remember what your husband has said. And he'll be of good cheer. Now eat this bread in remembrance of him. How much he loved you. Don't be sad, but do it in remembrance of him. Remember his love. Remember his words. Remember his action. Do this in remembrance of me. So after they finished drinking that, eating that bread, that periyappa, or that elder, he will take the cup, bless the cup, and give to all the people in that house. Drink this in remembrance of him. Remember your appa. Don't forget him. He died, he passed away. So these disciples, poor people, they are kids. Kids like following Jesus Christ. If Jesus dies, nobody is going to have this feast for them. There will be no periyappa, there will be no tata. Nobody is going to break their sorrow. Nobody is going to bring consolation to them. So that ceremony, symbolically, Jesus conducted and said, do this in remembrance of me. Do this in remembrance of me. So when we participate in the Lord's Supper, it is not just we are eating his flesh, not eating his blood. We are participating in this feast in remembrance of his death. There is an element of consolation in it. So Jesus said, do this in remembrance of me. My dear brother, my dear sister. But there it's not very clear how we should do this in remembrance of him. Is it a commandment only to the disciples, or it is a commandment given to the church? We go to Corinthians. In 1 Corinthians chapter 10, Paul talks about that. And in 11 he continues, in 11:23, for I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you. It's a tradition, church tradition. Paul was not in the upper room when Jesus was instituting the Lord's Supper, the New Testament. Paul was not in the upper room. But God revealed that to Paul, exactly what happened in the upper room. What Matthew, Mark, Luke has written, Paul had as a revelation. He says, I have received from the Lord, from Jesus Christ, that which also I delivered unto you. It's a tradition, handing over. It's a church tradition. Paul received from the Lord, gave to Corinthians. Like exchanging batons. From generation to generation, we receive this revelation, we receive this teaching from our forefathers. So what Paul received from the Lord, he has given that handed over. So church tradition, from this only we get the word tradition. So then the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed. So night comes first, then the day comes later. So for us, the day first, night later. For them, it's the evening and morning one day. So night and day. So day is after the night. So the night in which he was going to be betrayed, the day, that date. When that night which he was to be betrayed, Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. And the same manner, also he took the cup. When he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament, same word he is using. The cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as oft as you drink it. As oft as you drink it in remembrance of me. So do this in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death till he come. You show the Lord's death till he come. So in that upper room, when they were participating that, Jesus didn't die. But in remembrance of his death, in foretelling his death, He observed that feast which has to be observed after death. But now the church, Jesus already died. So we commemorate, we remember and celebrate his death in remembrance of him. What is that we remember? We do show the Lord's death till he come. So how should we observe this last supper? We should show the death of Christ, number one. It is not that I eat bread, it is not that I drink of that cup. You should manifest, you should exhibit, you should put it on you, the death of life. You should manifest that Jesus died for you in your life. What all the blessings one can have because of the death of Jesus, show that. Show that Jesus died for your sins. Show that the death of Jesus has delivered you. The death of the Passover lamb has delivered them from Egypt. Show that the death of Jesus Christ has delivered you from sin. Delivered you from old ways. Delivered you from your old mindset. You have repented for that. You have forsaken that. Show that, brother, sister, younger. Show that. So how should you participate in the Lord's Supper? Criteria number one, you should show the death of Jesus in every possible way. Jesus died for me. If you can't show that, ceremoniously eating this bread and drinking of this cup is meaningless. You must show that you died to sin, died to the system of the world, to the rudiments of the world, to the traditions of the world, for your old ways, for your old thinking. You are dead. You are dead, you died. You must be able to manifest that in your life, that's number one. My dear brother, my dear sister, show the Lord's death. Number two, until he comes. Till he comes. So on one side, show the world the death of Jesus. On the other side, you see the coming of Jesus. It has got a number of things that I could tell you in the coming of Jesus. You should believe that Jesus is coming again. You should be ready to meet your God. Your focus in 2020, I want to have an auditorium that will accommodate 25,000 people. In 2035, I'll have a worldwide ministry. Many people got their plans like that. My dear brother, my dear sister, I don't say that we should not have a bigger church. I don't say we should not have a plan for anything. But our focus is not having a big, when you need a big auditorium, God will give a big auditorium. But God's plan for you, he comes again. Anytime Jesus would come again, so I should be ready to meet Jesus. Whether Jesus comes again or not, before that, Jesus will come again, but we don't know when will he be coming again. But anytime our death may come. So somehow we should be ready to meet the Lord. That will happen. Whether I got 100 believers, or 2,000 believers, or 20,000 believers, or 200,000 believers, one day I'll die. Every great man will die. A king or a prime minister or a president of any nation, he or she would die. So we have to prepare ourselves to meet God. So on one side, show the death of Jesus in your life. So it's a very important move. You're a Christian means you're showing Jesus died for you, you're living in the same sin, in the same adultery, in the same fornication, the same lying, the same taking liquor. You show that the death of Jesus has not helped you. Death of Jesus Christ has not changed you. By your action, you are confessing to the world that the death of Jesus is meaningless. So do likewise. Sanctify yourself unto that end. Jesus died for that. My dear brother, my dear sister. On the other side, see the Lord's coming. Jesus is coming again. So our total focus must be on the return of Jesus Christ. So how do we participate in the Lord's Supper? On one side, we must be able to show the death of Jesus in our life. On the other side, we must have our attention focused on the coming of Jesus Christ. And the third one, this is very important. 1 Corinthians 11, 27 and 28. Wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. What is this? Wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily. How many of you can say that you are worthy enough? You are worthy enough to participate, to eat this bread and drink of this cup. I'm worthy for it. Perfect. I'm the right person. How many of you can say that? Are you worthy? Are you worthy? Worthy enough to eat? Eat this bread? Drink of this cup? Are you worthy? Here it says very clearly. Wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. Can anybody say that you are worthy enough to eat? I don't want to ask you to put your hands up. None of us can say, I am worthy to eat this bread. I am worthy to eat a drink of this cup. Many times people in a very gentle way, oh, I am not worthy. I am not worthy. Okay, I had a fight with my wife. I am not worthy. I'm given to liquor, I'm not worthy. I had a small problem in my office, I'm not worthy. In a very gentle way they walk out. You're not worthy to participate in the Lord's Supper. How will you be worthy to go to the kingdom of heaven? How can you be fit to go to the kingdom of heaven? Eating this bread, eating this, drinking of this cup, will do a magic in your life to go to heaven? Is there any magic power in it? I don't believe in a magical power in it. With all reverence I tell you. There is power in it. The bread that we bless, the cup that we bless, there is power in it. Efficacy. No doubt about it. But nevertheless, it's just bread. But we do this in remembrance of the Lord. So it is not our worthiness. Nobody, please listen carefully, please listen carefully. We cannot eat, we cannot drink because of our worthiness. So many a time this has been misunderstood, misinterpreted. Nobody can be worthy enough to participate in this bread. Nobody can be worthy enough to drink of that cup. Now please come with me to that verse again. Please, if you got a copy of the Bible, please come with me to that verse again. Then you will understand correctly. Wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily. It is not whether you are worthy enough or not. It is your eating of this bread must be worthy enough. Drinking of this cup must be worthy enough. I tell you a little bit of grammar. This unworthily is not used here as an adjective. Can anybody tell me what's an adjective? Children must be able to say what's an adjective. What children? What's an adjective? Adjective is not putting heads down. What's an adjective? Huh? They look at me, put their head down. What's an adjective, man? It's not in CA. As he's saying, describes.
A noun.
Oh, wonderful. Give him a big hand. An adjective describes a noun. An adjective describes a noun. That unworthily is not an adjective. It doesn't describe that person. It doesn't describe whether that person is worthy or that person is not worthy. It doesn't describe that person. It is not don't be unworthy to eat it. Don't be unworthy to drink of this cup. It doesn't say don't be unworthy, don't be an unworthy person to eat this. Don't be an unworthy person to drink of this cup. So it's not an adjective there. It says, whether you're a worthy person or unworthy person, don't eat unworthily. Don't drink of this cup unworthily. So here that unworthily is not an adjective. What is the part of this grammar? If it's not adjective, what is it? Nobody? Only Simon is ready. I think Simon can understand grammar better. So what is this now? Not an adjective then it is? Adverb. Give him again one more clap. Adverb. describes the action. Adverb describes the action. That eating must be done worthily. That eating, drinking of this cup must be done worthily. You are going to participate in this. You are a Christian. It's not because of your standard. It's not a question whether you are worthy or unworthy. But eat this bread worthily. Drink of this cup worthily. What is eating this worthily? What is that manner that I should follow in eating this bread? What is the manner that I should follow in drinking of this cup? I'm going to share with you just 5 points. Find out whether you are worthy or you are not worthy to participate in the Lord's Supper. Number one. It's a New Testament. It's a New Testament he has made with his blood. Prove that you are believer. Prove that you are a Christian. It doesn't mean that you have to bring you a baptism certificate. Really believe in Christ. Really are showing the death of Jesus in your life. You are not guilty of his body. Jesus died on the cross. He shed his blood for me on the cross. That has saved me. That has delivered me from my sin. That has made me perfect. Now I am following Jesus. I am a follower of Jesus. I am not a member of Carmel Christian Assembly. Member of Carmel Christian Assembly doesn't qualify you to participate in this bread. If at all I can say that, I say that nonsense. It makes no sense. Because you are a member of Carmel Christian Assembly, you are participating in this bread. Can you truly say that you are a follower of Jesus Christ? That qualifies you for this eating. You become worthy. Your eating becomes worthy. You are showing the death of Jesus in your life. You imitate Jesus. There's a small quarrel between husband and wife. Husband, you imitate Jesus. Wife, you imitate Jesus. When they revile at you, you are not reviling back. When they are scolding you, shouting at you, you are not shouting back. You are imitating Jesus. When you suffer, you don't threaten. You imitate Jesus. In an accusation, in a situation, your daddy is shouting at you. He's wrong. Justice is taken away. You're fighting for justice. You are not proving that you are a Christian. You humble yourself even when justice is taken away. You keep quiet. You imitate Christ. You are a believer. You are proving you are a Christian. It's not a question whether you are worthy enough or not. There's eating worthily. There's participating worthily. The manner in which you can participate. So now please When you come for this Lord's Supper, eating worthily depends upon not what type of a person you are, what's your mindset? What's your actions in the past? There must have been ups and downs. You might have failed. Once, twice, seven times, 77 times. Even 77 times in a day. But still there is a bell ringing in you. I must imitate Jesus. I must imitate Jesus. I must imitate Jesus. You back answer your husband, but immediately you feel sorry. Oh, sorry Jesus, I should be like you. Within a few minutes, you back answer your husband. Again he said, no, no Lord, I must be sorry. After 2 hours, in an argument you fought for your right. Then he said, no Lord, not for my right. I'm sorry Lord. You are one that justifies me. 7 times in a day. But your mindset is, I must follow Jesus. Not 7 times, 70 times. But still your mindset, I must follow Jesus. I must seek the kingdom of God. I must repent. I must believe. My dear brother, my dear sister, when you are with that, when you do everything with that mindset, you will be doing this worthily. When you don't have the mindset, you don't fight at all. You do all good things, but you don't have a mindset to follow Jesus. By nature, you are good or timid, or whatever that can be. You are a good person. It's not that you have got a mindset to follow Jesus, but you are a good person. That doesn't make you worthy to participate in the Lord's Supper. Not all good people can participate. Is a good people or a bad people? A mindset. You are a follower of Christ. You want to apply Christian principles in your life, in your business, in your family setup, in your career, in college, in school. You want to be a Christian. You want to prove that you are a Christian. You want to be an example as a believer. So proving yourself a believer, then you are participating in this Lord's Supper worthily. Number two, it's very, very important. Participate regularly with preparedness. Participate regularly with preparedness. In the Bible we read, day of preparation. Day of preparation. Is not preparing this grape juice, is not preparing this bread. Prepare yourself. Participate regularly. Okay, this is the Lord's day. Today we have got the Lord's Supper. Whenever there is Lord's Supper, be regular. Okay, possible I'll come. Now I got a friend coming, so I will skip this. Today we have to go to our native place. I'll skip this. We all are going for a picnic. I'll skip this. You don't have respect for this table. For you, picnic is more important than this table. For you, your relatives are more important than this table. For you, your business is more important than this table. You are not eating this worthily. Today, you are eating this because it's you are available. No other important work. No other business contract to be signed. No other picnic place you want to go. No other holiday you want to enjoy. Okay, one better thing that you can do is go to the Lord's table. That's why we read in the book of Malachi, the table of the Lord is become contempt. கர்த்தருடைய பந்தி எண்ணமற்று போயிட்டு. தட் இஸ் நோ டியூ இம்பார்ட்டன்ஸ் டு இட். ஸோ வென் யூ கீப் திஸ் ஃபர்ஸ்ட் யூட் பி ஏபிள் டு ஷெட்யூல் எவ்ரி திங் எல்ஸ் அக்கார்டிங்லி. நோ ஐ கனாட் கம் பிகாஸ் டுடே ஐ ஹாவ் டு பார்ட்டிசிபேட் இன் த லார்ட்ஸ் சப்பர். மை டியர் பிரதர், மை டியர் சிஸ்டர், வென் எவர் வி கேதர் வி கேன் ஹேவ் த லார்ட்ஸ் டேபிள். இட்ஸ் நாட் ஓன்லி த every Sunday. We don't have a prescription, but the general guideline, whenever we gather. But when there is the Lord's Supper, this gathering becomes unique. We are going to participate in the Lord's table. In remembrance of His death, we are going to eat this bread. In remembrance of His blood, we are going to drink of this cup. So we prepare ourselves. We have an excitement in this, a joy in it. I'm going to participate in it. So number one, prove that you are a Christian, you are a believer, you are a child of God. Number two, participate in it regularly with preparedness. When you participate regularly with preparedness, again I tell you, it's not your quality. Not your quality, you are worthy or not. You are participating regularly, then you are participating worthily. You don't participate regularly, you are pushing it in your priority list, third or fourth or fifth. Then you are not participating worthily. You are not eating worthily. You are not drinking worthily. It's not just eating a small piece of bread. It's not just drinking a small, maybe 20 ml, 20 ml of grape juice. You can drink bottle and bottle of wine. What's the use of drinking this 20 ml of grape juice? Pallila patta naakla kuda padavadu. What is special in drinking this grape juice? If your mindset is not prepared for participating in the Lord's Supper, you are participating unworthily. You are participating unworthily. What is after all in this 20 ml of grape juice? I don't think it's going to be 30 ml. If you ask me how do I measure it, I remember one ink bottle is 60 ml. So half of an ink bottle will be 30 ml. That's why I said it will be 20 ml. Participate worthily, eat worthily, drink worthily. It's not whether you are a worthy person or not. That unworthily doesn't qualify you, that unworthily qualifies your action. Are you regular to this? Have you come prepared for this? What's your action? Does your action prove that you are a Christian? Does your action prove that you participate regularly with preparedness? My dear brother, my dear sister, let me go to the third one. How you can participate in it? Participate. Number three, reverential. What the Lord put in my heart, I have noted down. How should I eat worthily? Not just eating in a hotel, not eating a muruku, not eating a small rusk, milk rusk. Participate in it reverentially, with fear and trembling. I do this in remembrance of the body of Jesus that was broken for me. I do that in remembrance of the blood of Jesus that is shed for me. Otherwise, you are eating and drinking this unworthily. Not a question whether a good person or a bad person, but that fear and trembling. I just tell you the points and conclude. Number four, when you participate, here the Bible says, examine yourself. In verse 28, examine yourself. Many messages you have heard. You read the Bible. If you participate unworthily, you are participating unto your own condemnation. You eat this bread unworthily, you are eating this bread unto your own condemnation. You drink this cup unworthily, you are drinking this cup unto your own condemnation. You might have many failures, but you are sincere to God. Introspect yourself. It's not left to me to examine you. In many churches, the pastors will examine them and say, no, no, you should not participate. You got this sin, you got that sin. You are taking this, you are taking that. You should not participate. You should not participate. I'm right or wrong from day one, I know it is left with God and you. The Bible doesn't say that I have to examine you and excommunicate you from the Lord's table. I cannot say, because of such and such sin, because you are watching movie yesterday, because you are fighting with your mummy yesterday, because you are not treating your daughter-in-law properly, because you talk to your sister like this, no, no, you cannot participate. Because you are not coming for last Sunday, you cannot participate. I am not here to examine you, but you have to examine yourself. And the Bible says clearly, examine yourself and participate. It doesn't say examine yourself and walk away. But I'm not pronouncing a curse. If you participate unworthily, you are eating this bread to your own condemnation. You are drinking of this cup to your own condemnation. Okay, I'm not worthy, so. No, you are not worthy or not. Participate worthily. Don't walk away. Repent. Believe. Get reconciled with God. Ask God to forgive you. Ask God to cleanse you. Feel sorry for what you have done. Don't have a mindset to continue in the same sin. You are not going to be any way better because you walk out without participating in it. No, you are not going to be better. You are not going to escape hellfire. It's better to have God's chastisement on you than go to hell. Because you are not participating unworthily, you are walking out. You are not going to escape hell, brother. Sister, you are not going to escape hell. After you know this salvation, after you know Jesus Christ, after you know the death of Jesus Christ, after you know after you made a covenant with Jesus Christ, after you received the Holy Spirit, after you heard all these blessings, you walk away. You cannot escape from hellfire. Participating unworthily, you cannot escape from condemnation. But this chastisement will help you that you are not condemned with the world. When the whole world, the unconverted sinners are sent to hell, you may not be sent to hell. You participate in it and be punished. That would be better to you. Maybe a fever may come, some sickness may come, some weakness may be found. You get time to correct yourself. Whatever condition, say feel sorry and participate. Even there was a mistake in you, even God punishes you for that, it's good for you that you are not condemned with the world. That you are not condemned with the world. If you walk away as a goody-goody person, oh, I got some sin, so I don't want to participate, I walk away. You cannot escape from the condemnation. My dear brother, my dear sister. I say one more thing before we could pray. Number five, enjoy total peace. In a few minutes' time, you're coming to the table. Peace with God. Peace with others. Peace within yourself. Thank you, Lord, that you have forgiven all my sins, all my shortcomings, all my weaknesses are laid on you. Thank you for the deliverance. I am your child, O Lord. A small illustration comes to my mind. There was a quarrel, a small quarrel, between that husband and wife. They went to bed without talking to one to another. They are lying on the same cot, facing in the opposite directions. Suddenly he felt, suppose this night if I die, I will not have time to say sorry to her. After all she has done for me, this is just a small quarrel. If at all I die today, I will not have time to say sorry to her. He just pulled her to his side. She was also in tears. She said, darling, sorry. They went to bed with peace. I bring this illustration to you. Suppose today is the last day for you. You are going to meet the Lord, maybe this evening, who knows, maybe for me, maybe for you, or tomorrow. Are you at peace with the Lord? Will you look at the Lord and smile? Will the Lord smile at you? If this is the last day for you, is there anything that you have to say sorry to your mommy, daddy, husband, wife, friend, unsettled accounts? You now to reconcile pandra time illama padte. When your spirit leaves you, will that leave with a peace within you? A three-dimensional peace with God, peace with others, peace within. Peace within. There was a rich man. He had always a fascination to count money. Every night he will count money. All the currencies he will count. All the bundles he will count. How much? He had a fascination for that. Suddenly one night, they call Yaman, or that angel of death, came. Suddenly he saw that in that room. It's only an imagination. The angel came and said, come on, come on. Hey, where are you? Come on, come on. Who are you? I'm so and so, I'm going to, ayo, no, I'm not ready. Come tomorrow. No, no, I can't come tomorrow and all. No, no, give me at least some time. No, no time can be given. Come. I have to count all this again one more time. No, no, you can't take. Can't I take this with me? No, you can't take this with me. I go, I'll tell my wife, I'm going. No, no, you can't tell your wife. I'll kiss my child. No, you don't have time. I can't give you time. Come, come, immediately we'll go. Finally he said, ask God and give me a few seconds. What are you going to do that few seconds? I have to write something very important. So God told that angel, okay, give him a few seconds. Exactly 5 seconds. He said, okay. Pulled out a paper, a pen. The last words he wrote, there will be no time. He died. There will be no time. He died. Now you can reconcile with God. Now you can take a decision. I will reconcile with my wife, my mother, my daughter, my neighbor. I'll set right my account. Now you can do it. Now you can make sure you got peace within. Shall we close our eyes? Do this in remembrance of me. Participate in this Lord's Supper in remembrance of me. Show his death in your life. Have your eyes fixed on the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. Eat this bread and drink this cup worthily. How do I eat this bread, drink this cup worthily? Prove that you are a Christian. Participate in it regularly with preparedness. Show the due respect for this. Reverentially participate in it. Make sure you're enjoying a peace with God, a peace with others, a peace within.